either chronologically going through the life of Christ through all four Gospels. In Luke chapter 1 and verse 5. In the time of Herod, king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah who belonged to the priestly division of Abijah. His wife Elizabeth was also a descendant of Aaron. Both of them were righteous in the sight of God, observing all the Lord's commands and decrees blamelessly. But they were childless because Elizabeth was not able to conceive, and they were both very old. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus Christ. And I just pray that you would just speak tonight, that you would feed us, that you would help us to receive something that would challenge us, change us, encourage us, give us hope, life. God, that we would be renewed in your presence. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
So, we are going to talk about the birth of John the Baptist, and more specifically, we're going to talk about his parents, and specifically his father, Zacharias. So, Zacharias is a Hebrew name, and it means Yahweh remembers. So what has happened here, God seems to delight, for whatever reason, throughout scriptures, you have Abraham and others who were kind of well beyond childbearing years, and they were not only did they not have children, but they were in a stage of life where they really physically weren't able to have children. And God seems to delight in intervening in those type of situations and manifesting himself. And this is one of those situations. Zechariah and his wife Elizabeth were not able to bear children, and as we're going to see, they were advanced in age. And the great lesson that we learned for that is, LJ and Bonnie, there's still hope. If you're interested, you never know. God is able at any time. So we'll see. So if you don't remember anything else tonight, maybe that'll be some spiritual help to you this week. So you have Zechariah, who was this priest, and he was a division of Abijah. And what the Bible means by that is, if you don't have to turn there, but in 1 Chronicles chapter 24, it lists there's 24 different sections of priests. There were so many priests that they had to divide them up into 24 sections. And Abijah is the eighth division or eighth section of the priest. And so what happened is they would take turns, and when it was your time, you would go into the temple in Jerusalem, and you would serve for 1 week, and you would do that twice a year. And this was Zechariah's turn, and so he goes into Jerusalem to serve in the temple. And it says in verse 6, it says, both of them were righteous in the sight of God, observing all the decrees, all the commands and decrees blamelessly. By the way, I'm preaching from the NIV tonight. Normally I preach out of the New King James, but tonight I'm preaching out of the NIV. Somebody asked me, how come I don't preach more out of the NIV? And I actually wanted to say this before I started. The reason, as I preached a few weeks ago, the NIV is a good version of the Bible. You can trust it, you can believe it. The reason why I choose not to is, for those of you who are not aware, in 2011, the NIV voted and made changes, like 1,600 changes, to become gender neutral. And I have great sympathy for women and for their fight and for the men who support them, but God chose to reveal himself masculine as a male, and so I don't want to argue with that, and because of that, that's why I choose to use, for the most part, the New King James Version. If you have an older NIV, it doesn't have that. The Spanish version is also correct. It doesn't have those changes in it, just the English version. But I just personally have issues. with changing God's word, if that's the way he chose to reveal himself, he should honor that. Anyways, so as we go on, it says that he was righteous in the sight of God, observing all the Lord's commands. And what the word righteous means in the Old Testament, it means to just try to live and do what God has required of you. Righteous in the Old Testament means to make an honest, sincere, heartfelt attempt. Now, the key word there is attempt. Okay? The word righteous in the New King James Version, in the King James, it uses the word blameless. And it's not talking about perfection. What he's talking about is people sincerely doing everything they can to obey all that God has for their lives. And it's important because we have a whole lot of people today and in Jesus' time who are very religious. And in their religiosity, they become very rigid. And they become so rigid sometimes that they can actually break. And when they break, they can also actually hurt and destroy a lot of people's lives. And the problem is they are following rules and regulations, and they're trying to, that's what Timothy says, they have a form of godliness. That is, they look good, they talk good. When you look at them, they look like they're sincere. They look like they belong to the family. They look like they're part of the family. But really, behind all of that is not a sincere heart that's hungry to follow after God. What's behind all of that is this religiosity that puffs up their own self-ego and makes themselves look good, not to God, but to themselves, and in their opinion, hopefully to others. It's like the man who walked into the temple. And he walks in, and he was a Pharisee, he's a religious leader, and he walks in, and in runs the sinner. And the sinner beats his chest and says, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. And the Pharisee comes in all proper and religious and stands up straight and says, oh God, I thank you that you have not allowed me to be like this no-good, dirty, rotten sinner over here. And God says that the sinner got up righteous. But the Pharisee left just as dirty as when he entered. And we have to be careful today because there's a whole lot of people who have a facade of religiosity. But it's not religion that saves, it's Jesus Christ. And today, and we sincerely try to keep the commands of God, but that's not what it's all about. What it's all about today is a relationship with Jesus Christ. And if we have this relationship with Him, then the Bible says that God puts both the desire and the ability in us to follow Him. And so we sincerely walk and try to live as Jesus would have us to walk and live. But it's not for a self-righteous, it's not for a show for other people. It's not putting on a mask of religiosity. It comes from a sincere, broken heart to be right with God and right before others. Zacharias and Elizabeth were righteous before God. Look at verse 7. I find this to be very interesting. Verse 7 says they were childless. Because Elizabeth was not able to conceive. Have you ever waited on God for something? And it just seems like you're talking to the ceiling. It seems like it's not doing any good, like your prayers are not getting through. And then Satan begins to work with your mind. You're not faithful enough. You don't have enough faith. You're not good enough. You're not doing enough. Your life hasn't changed enough. There's something in you. You're just really no good. And God really doesn't love you. And God really can't bless you. And you're going through all of this not because God has some plan or it's not God's timing, but you're going through this because of you. And the sad thing is, there are a whole lot of preachers and teachers, pastors and churches who also teach this. It's called name it and claim it, grab it, you can have it theology. The only problem is it's not biblical. These were righteous people. They were right before God. Their heart was right. They were doing what God wanted them to do. In the midst of doing and being obedient to God, for whatever reason, and we're going to find out here in a little bit why, God said no. Actually, his answer wasn't no. His answer was not now. Wait. How many times in our lives do we have something that we want? Something that we feel we need to have. Something that we beg God for. And God says, wait. But I don't want to wait. It's difficult here. It's painful here. God, I want it now. Wait. But God, if I wait, I'm just going to die. I'm not going to make it. Wait. And his answer may be no. I've shared with you a few times, and a number of years ago I was engaged to be married to Yvonne Flores, was her name. Her father, believe it or not, was the Bill Gaither of Latin America. Incredibly famous. I think he had 216 albums that he recorded. And we were ready to get married. And the father said no. In fact, the father and I went to do a crusade in Chile. And while we were in Chile, he said, I've got to go to Argentina to take care of something over there. I'll be gone for 3 days and I'll be back. And my father's here and he's going to take care of you and blah, 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 blah. And so I was preaching and he was gone. What I didn't know was he was in Chile or Argentina, married his daughter off to one of my friends. He didn't tell me anything about it. And I was just broken. God, how could you? God, why would you? God. And I was angry and bitter. And God, do something. And God just seemed like he was enjoying himself. But you know, God knew what he was doing. I don't think we would have made it for very long. God knows the end from the beginning. And even though we don't understand why, he has a reason. And he says, wait for my timing. And let me just jump in here and say real quick, this is free of charge. A whole lot of you are getting yourselves in trouble because you just cannot live alone, you cannot be by yourself, and you just feel like you cannot wait, and you jump into relationships, and you jump too fast and too far into those relationships until you get yourself in trouble, and then when it falls apart, you get mad at God, and God says, wait, what I have for you is far better. Wait. Verse 8, Once when Zechariah's division was on duty, he was serving as priest before God. He was chosen by lot, according to the custom of the priesthood, to go into the temple of the Lord to burn incense. And when the time for the burning of incense came, all the assembly worshippers were praying outside. Then the angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing at the right side of the altar. When Zechariah saw him, he was startled and was gripped with fear. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard." So could you imagine this situation? Zechariah is in the Holy Ghost. And he goes in there, light the incense. And he's got a rope tied around him in case he has sinned and he doesn't make it out. And then drops dead there. In the midst of all that, an angel appears. Now, how would you react? They'd probably poke me out with a rope. He was afraid. And the angel appears to him in a supernatural way. Now let me just stop here and say what I'm going to talk about, what I'm going to add in 3 weeks to our message is I want to talk about angels because we have this misunderstanding about angels in our time. There's all kinds of foolishness and false thinking and teaching on angels. There's even books written on how to talk to demons, which are fallen angels, and all of this kind of stuff. People who are worshiping angels, and people who have angels who are in charge of certain names. God's in charge of it all. So I want to talk about that, but we need to understand a few things about angels. First of all, angels, including Satan and the fallen angels, were created by God. They are servants of His, and God is the one who sent this angel as His messenger, because that's what angels are. They're messengers, they're servants. And believe it or not, the Bible says that the angels are just below us. We're a little bit higher than the angels. The Bible also says that we're going to judge the angels. And in fact, there's nothing written, and this is just speculation, but it very possibly could be that that's what made Satan and the angels mad, and why that some of the angels mad, and why there was rebellion, because they didn't understand why all of this was going on and why God would allow this. They were created before day one. When they were created, we don't know, but they were created before day one because Job tells us that they were watching and rejoicing when the world was created, when God formed the foundations of the earth. And I can't recall, I was trying all week to recall, I don't see any place in the Bible where it says we have a guardian angel. If anybody knows where that's at or knows a place, please let me know afterwards. But I don't know the place. But the Bible does say that God sends His angels to watch over and care for us. Yes. And so angels are actively working, and not just with believers, but also with unbelievers, because the Bible says that Satan, the way that he works, is he deceives people and spiritually blinds their eyes. And those blinders need to be removed. And we're in a spiritual warfare. And I believe that part of that spiritual warfare are those angels fighting to help remove those blinders on our behalf. Commercial. 3 weeks, we'll finish the rest of it. But angels are real. Angels are part of God's plan. And this angel came and appeared. And what does he say? Fear not, because God is listening to you. Even though you're in distress, even though you seem like God is not listening, because, you know, listen, most of the people in this room, we don't have kids, and it's not a problem. But to these guys, it was a curse not to have kids. Your blessing was based on how many kids you had. And so here were these righteous people serving God who had no kids. They were frustrated, and God sent a messenger to say, God's listening. God's paying attention. God is going to do something. And I just want to encourage you tonight, no matter what you're going through, no matter how far away you think God is, God is here. God is paying attention. And God is listening to your prayers. God is hearing your every cry. The last part of verse 13. Your wife, Elizabeth, will bear you a son, and you are to call him John. He will be a joy and a delight to you, and many people will rejoice because of his birth, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He is never to take wine or any other fermented drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even before he was born. Two things here that I want you to see. Number one, this is a Nazarite vow. This is what John was taken to keep his entire life. This is outlined, if you're interested, in the book of Numbers. I can't remember exactly what chapter, but if you want to go to bed early tonight, start reading Numbers when you get home, and you will probably fall asleep before you find it. Numbers is a very boring book. The second thing is, and this is not going to be politically correct, but God oftentimes is not. One of the things that I see there that I hope that you see is, he's to be filled with the Holy Spirit when? No. From before his birth. While he is in his mother's womb, he is going to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Hold your place there and go to Jeremiah. Jeremiah chapter 1. In verse 4. The word of the Lord came to me saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. I appointed you as a prophet to the nations. God had a plan for Jeremiah before he was born. Two things with this. Number one, that's a child that a woman is carrying at conception. I don't want to get into the arguments and parameters beyond that at this point, but that's a child. The Bible makes it very, very clear. And we need to be careful with messing with what God has clearly laid out. I want to challenge you and challenge you to look at what God has to say and what science has to say about abortion, about terminating a child's life. And I'm not talking about a real radical right-wing agenda. I'm talking about what God has to say about these things. Because I think oftentimes we let society dictate for us, and because society, particularly right now, the way things are, it's all, you know, women's rights, women's rights, women's rights, women's rights, and I'm going to be real blunt. That's one good thing about this kind of thing, I think, because you don't have a lot of children running around. My pastor used to say it this way. Is it a woman's choice? Yes, it is a woman's choice. But the choice was made when she decided to get into bed and not use protection. Not 4 months later. So we need to be careful. And there's a whole lot of things, and I'm aware of all of that as far as women's lives and all of that. I'm for all of that. We just need to be careful. Just go one extreme or the other and rally behind the extreme, particularly when God very clearly has something to say about the subject. We always have to bring God and His Word into the picture, whether we like it or not, whether it's comfortable or not. We always have to do so. That's why we took up the offering before it was. But look at this. This child, the reason why God wanted them to wait was because this child was going to be a supernatural child. This child had, God had a plan, and God was going to use this child to present the Messiah, the Savior, to the world. There was a reason why God said, wait. God knew what it was, and God may not show up when we want, but He always, always, always shows up on time. And this is God's timing. God is in control. Verse 18. Zechariah asked the angel, how can I be sure of this? I am an old man, and my wife is well along in years. The angel said to him, I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God, and I have been sent to speak to you and tell you this good news. And now you will be silent and not able to speak until the day this happens, because you did not believe my words, which will come true at the appointed time. Doubt. Here is Zechariah, who, just like you and I, is presented with a supernatural situation. God very clearly speaks to him through this angel, through this message, gives him instruction, tells him what he wants to do. He's like, I don't know. Can I really trust this, believe this? How often do we do that? How often does God give us a clear word through His Word? Well, wait a minute. I haven't had an experience to validate that. I haven't felt. No. God very clearly spoke, and we need to be obedient to what? Not the preacher, not some friend of ours, not some prophet over here, so-and-so. We need to be obedient to God and His Word. And God speaks clearly. Too many people are confused as to what God wants them to do when God very clearly tells them what He wants you to do. What does He want you to do? What does He want you to be saved? First step, get saved. Number two, He wants you in His Word. Number three, He wants you to pray. Number four, He wants you to be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. Number five, the Word very clearly says He wants us to live in righteousness, specifically to avoid fornication. Number six, He wants us to obey the laws of the land, those that God has placed over. That the Bible very clearly says with each one of these points, this is God's will. But yet, many of us are not willing to even do half of those things. And we don't understand why God isn't speaking to us and giving us His will over here. He's not going to reveal Himself here until we are over here. And then what will happen? Well, Psalm 37 tells us that when we do that, when we obey Him and put those things into practice in our lives, that God will give us the desires of our hearts. Well, why the desires of our heart? Because our heart will be God's heart, so we're going to want and desire the thing that God desires for us. They spoke. He got the word. But he had doubts. Verse 21, meanwhile, the people were waiting for Zechariah and wondering why he stayed so long in the temple. When he came out, he could not speak to them. What happened is typically in Numbers 6:24 to 26, there's a blessing. So when the priest came out, he would speak this blessing to them. But when he came out, he couldn't speak. He couldn't get the blessing. And the people knew he'd been in there so long. And so because he couldn't speak, because he didn't get the blessing, because he'd been in there so long, because it was fearful, they looked at that tent and they realized that he had been in the presence of God and he had seen a vision. Verse 23. When his time of service was completed, he returned home. After this, his wife Elizabeth became pregnant, and for 5 months remained in seclusion. The Lord has done this for me, she said. In these days, he has shown his favor and taken away my disgrace among the people. And with this, I want to close. Verse 23. When his time of service was completed, he returned home. Zechariah was called and gifted by God for a job. And he went into the job, and something happened, and he wasn't able to speak. He wasn't able to communicate. Most of us would have been filing for workman's comp. Most of us would have decided it was time to take a break and rest. Most of us would have decided, okay, well, I did what I could. Now I can't do it anymore. No, Zacharias was righteous before God. He said, I have a call of God. I have a duty before God. And I am going to stay, fight it out. And I am going to complete the will of God for my life. And then when I am done, then I will go home. I say this to say that I believe there's a problem in the church. And I don't mean this church. I mean just the church in general in the United States. That we bail out too quickly. The going gets rough, and so we get running. We get tired, and we don't want to fulfill our commitments. Money gets tight, and so we want to find another way out. And there are too many people. First of all, if you are here a part of this body, it's because God called you. Not only has God called you, but he has gifted and equipped you for a ministry, for a service. And in equipping and gifting you, he expects, God expects, for you and I to be faithful in fulfilling what we have committed ourselves to. And if we are faithful in committing ourselves to that, then God will bless us for our faithfulness, and we will plant seed, and God will water the seed, and God will cause growth as a result of our being faithful to what God has called us to do. Now I'm just going to be real blunt here. Dr. Rod has a ministry, and he's here tonight. And I know you people get tired of hearing me talk about it, but the ministry, I think, is one of the best around. And the reason is because he goes to a park, he feeds homeless people that nobody else cares about, but not does he just go and feeds them. He loves them, he takes care of them. He would do stuff, to be honest with you, that I don't like to do. I have seen him hug them, I have seen him touch them, and I don't want to touch Rod because I'm wondering if I'm going to get fleas or something from him. Don't laugh, you guys feel the same way. That's why you don't go to the park and show up and help. And he's been doing it 8 years now?
Ten.
How many Tuesdays have you missed?
We haven't missed a Tuesday in 9 years.
You what?
We haven't missed.
Except for when I didn't show up.
Yeah. By the way, he just forgot to let us know.
tomato stuff is it. We were fine. It was good.
But I have been there. And I have seen people that God has rescued from that. Because he is faithful in doing what God has called him to do. He doesn't try to do more. He does what God has called him to do. We have been through the ringer trying to get musicians in here. Bob and Elnora, they're both members of other churches. But they came, they did what God called them to do, they're faithful in it. And we may not have the best rock group around. But our music is better now than it was when we started. And God takes that and he blesses it. But too many people. Now listen, I want you to listen carefully. Forget about everything else I've said and just listen to this because this is what I want to talk to you about. I don't want to be legalistic in this, and I very easily could, but too many people find excuses not to do or be where they know God wants them to be. Let me just be real blunt. There's something wrong. Listen, if you're tired, sometimes the most holy thing that you can do is on Saturday night, stay home and sleep. It really is. This church isn't going to fall down because you miss us on Saturday night. If you need to rest, rest. You don't need to be at every activity the church has. You don't need to be every place. The Holy Spirit is there to do that, not you. Sometimes we need to rest. But at the other side of that, we spend too much time looking for excuses not to do and be where God wants us to be. There's something wrong when you are too sick to come to church, but the same night are well enough to go to the restaurant and eat. There's something wrong when you are too tired to come to church, but yet at 10 o'clock you're able to go to Ripples. There's something wrong. And we're too busy giving excuses. Including, I've done this for 30 years and I put my time in. I'm good for you. God is happy with that. Bless you for your 30 years. But is God done with you yet? I don't think so. You may not be able to do what you did 30 years ago, but God has something for you now. And it may just be staying at home and being a prayer warrior for those of us who need the prayer. And that's okay. As long as you are actually in the battle on your knees in prayer. Do you understand what I'm trying to say? There's something wrong with our commitment to God when anything can distract us. And we go get so distracted so quickly and so easily that so many things just fall by the wayside. We have to put our eyes on the prize. And the prize is Jesus Christ. And we have to keep our eyes focused on him, the author and finisher of our faith, and allow him to give us the strength that we need
to run the race, to finish the race, and to be victorious in the race.
If you can't say amen, at least say ouch. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus Christ. And we thank you because you died on a cross, shed your blood, and by our faith we were able to apply that blood to our lives, and we have now been washed, made whiter than snow. We have been purged from our sin and forgiven. We have been made righteous in your eyes, not because of anything that we have done, but because our faith in what you did over 2,000 years ago. God, help us. Strengthen our faith. Encourage us. God, there are people here who are just waiting and feel tired. God, in the name of Jesus Christ, help them to realize, strengthen them, and help them to realize that you are listening to their prayers and you've heard their prayers and you have an answer for them. And give us the strength and courage and patience to wait. We thank you, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ. And everyone said,
amen.